Ramadhan.
Welcome, O Ramadan.
The month of mercy and blessings. Fasting does not mean to stay hungry and thirsty and make it troublesome for you. Fasting is an act of self-restraint. Do not speak evil. Do not see evil. Do not think evil. Do not do anything indecent. Fasting is a trial for the believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's triumph in this trial according to the guidelines of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I'll be there for you all through this glorious month of Ramadan. Let's make it more fruitful and reward worthy. Share it with me every day throughout this blessed month.
Let's benefit from Ramadan. Meet Dr. Zakir Naik in Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakir, next on Peace TV.
Muhammad, peace pearls of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that Allah's Messenger, peace be upon him, said, "The signs of a hypocrite are three. Whenever he speaks, he tells a lie. Whenever he promises, he always breaks it. If you trust him, he proves to be dishonest." Sahih al-Bukhari, Volume 1, Kitabul Iman, Book of Faith, Chapter 24, Hadith Number 33.
Oh, you who believe, give charity for the pleasure of Allah. The pleasure of Allah. Oh, you who believe, read the Quran every night of Ramadan. Night of Ramadan. Welcome, O Ramadan. It is Ramadan. It is Ramadan.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. Welcome to the show, Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakir. I'm your host, Yusuf Chambers. You may know me from the previous shows. And today, inshallah, we will be discussing the topic, Ramadan, the month of repentance, part 2. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Zakir.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you?
Fine, thank you, alhamdulillah.
The next question really for me would be, why is it such a special thing to seek repentance during this holy, blessed month of Ramadan?
This month is special because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgives His slaves, His servants, the maximum in this month. Therefore, it is given the title Ramadan, the month of forgiveness. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in the Hadith of Tirmidhi, in the Book of Fasting, Hadith number 682, where our beloved Prophet Muhammad said that when the first night of Ramadan comes, the devils and the demons, they are chained. And the gates of hell are closed. Not even a single gate is open. And the gates of heaven, they are open. Not even a single gate is closed. And the caller, he calls to the people that, oh, those who want to do good, please come. And those who are doing evil, please desist. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He ransoms His slaves. And He does that every night of Ramadan. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, He further said, it's mentioned in a Sahih Hadith of Tirmidhi, Hadith number 3545, where the beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, once he goes on the pulpit before giving a khutbah, and he says, "Ameen, Ameen, Ameen," thrice. So the people ask, that, "Oh Messenger, why?" So the Messenger of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala says that Archangel Gabriel had come to him and said that anyone who does not have his sins forgiven after Ramadan has approached, and enters hellfire, ask Allah to keep a distance from him. And then Gabriel says to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say Ameen. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says Ameen. Means it's unfortunate that anyone witnesses the month of Ramadan and does not have his sins forgiven, because this is the month of forgiveness. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the book of fasting, hadith number 1901, that if anyone fasts in the complete month of Ramadan with belief and seeking the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all his past sins will be forgiven. That's the reason Ramadan is called as the month of forgiveness.
Subhanallah. And Dr. Zakia, we used to have a saying back in the days before I embraced Islam, that I wish it could be Christmas every day. And I'm going to say, I wish it could be Ramadan every day now, more appropriately. What are the prerequisites for sincere tawbah? And could you possibly enlighten us with some prophetic traditions of some of the prophets making tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Allah says in the Quran in Surah Tahreem, chapter number 66, verse number 8, that, Ya al-lazina amanu, O you believe, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincere repentance. And there are basically 5 prerequisites for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept the tawbah. Number 1, the person should accept that he is doing is wrong. Number 2, he should immediately stop it. Number 3, he should seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 4, he should not commit that act again. And number 5, if he has taken something from any other human being, and if he can return it, he should turn it back. For example, if he has robbed some money, he should turn the money back. If he has taken some wealth, he should give the wealth back. If he can undo the harm, he should do it. And according to Ibn Qayyim, he says that repentance is accepted when the person does not do that evil act again, and it further helps him to do good deeds and prevents him from going back to that act. According to Imam An-Nawawi, he says there are 3 prerequisites for any tawbah to be accepted. Number 1, he should stop the act what he's doing. Number 2, he should ask for forgiveness. Number 3, he should not do it again. And he says there's a 4th requirement: if he has done some harm to any other human being, then he should undo it if he can. And there are various examples in the hadith which give that how people have asked for forgiveness. It's mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 4, in the book of Stories of the Prophet, hadith number 3470, that there was a person who had committed 99 murders. So he wants to seek repentance. So he asked the people that, how can he do it? So they send him to a monk. So monk says that you have killed 99 people, there's no chance of forgiveness. So that person, that murderer, he kills the monk too. And now he has committed 100 murders. So he goes to another person and says that I want to seek repentance. So he says that if you want to seek repentance, go to that land where people are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, you should leave the land in which you have committed the crime, and go to that land where people are seeking repentance, and inshallah, Allah will grant you forgiveness. So he immediately goes towards that land, but on his way, death takes place and he dies. And he turns his chest towards that village where people are repenting. Then both the angels of good and the angels of bad, both come and they want to take him. The angels from the heaven say that we will take him because he wants to repent. But the angels from the bad deeds, the hell, they say, no, he has not committed a single good deed. We will take him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intervenes. And he asks the village where people are repenting that it should come closer to the person who has committed murder. And he commands to the place where he has committed the crime that it should go further away. So when they measure the distance, they find out that the person who committed the murder, he was one span closer to the village where people are repenting. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him Jannah. So this is an example that a person commits 100 murder and he wants to repent. Only the niyyah of repenting and traveling towards that place, and a different version of the same hadith says that while dying, he pushes himself towards the, and he looks towards the place they can get forgiveness. So this shows that only the niyyah and the intention to fast for forgiveness, Allah forgives. There is another example in Sahih Muslim, volume number 3, in the book of Hudud, hadith number 4207. There was a lady from the tribe of Juhayna. She comes to the Prophet and she had committed adultery and she was pregnant. So she comes to the Prophet and says that I have done so and so sin. Please give me punishment. So the Prophet calls her master and says, take care of this woman till she delivers the child. And after that, get her to me. So the master, he takes care of her. And after she gives birth to a child, he gets the woman. Then the Prophet says, because of the adultery, she has to be given the hath penalty. And the lady, she's asked to wrap around herself with her cloth. And the people stone her to death. And after she dies, the Prophet, he prays for her. So Umar ibn Allah, pleased with him, says that, O Prophet, you're praying for a woman who has committed adultery? Then the Prophet replies that the way she has repented, even if you distribute this repentance to 70 people of Medina, it will be sufficient for them to go to Jannah. Who can repent better than the woman who is willing to give her life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? A similar example is given in Sahih Muslim, volume number 3, in the book of Hudud, hadith number 4205, that Ma'az bin Malik, may Allah be with him, he comes to the Prophet and he says that, please purify me. The Prophet says, woe to you. Go and ask for forgiveness for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you repent. The person, he goes back, again he comes and says that, O Messenger, please pardon me. He says, woe to you. Ask for forgiveness for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you repent. Again the person goes, again he comes for the third time. O Messenger of Allah, please purify me. He says, go away from you. Ask for repentance. Ask forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again the fourth time he comes and he says to the Prophet, please pardon me. The Prophet says, from what? So Ma'az, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that, from adultery. So he says, are you mad? Have you gone crazy? So the person says, no, I'm not mad. Then the Prophet asks that, are you drunk? Did you have khamar? Did you have wine? So the other people get up and they smell his mouth. They said, no, Prophet. He said, no khamar. He said, did you really commit adultery? He says, yes, I've committed adultery. And I want the punishment for the sin I've committed. So the Prophet asked the people to stone him. And he stoned to death. After he stoned to death, there's a controversy between the Sahabas and the two groups of people. One group of people say that he has been undone. That means it's a pity that, you know, that he will not get maghfirah undone. The other group says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted, Allah has accepted his repentance and he shall go to Jannah. This happens for 2 or 3 days. Then the beloved Prophet ﷺ comes and then he tells to the Sahabas that pray for Ma'az ibn Malik because he has repented for a sin. And if you distribute his repentance, even in a large number of people, in a group of people, it will be sufficient. Here it shows that the people, they committed a major sin, but they repented. They were even willing to have themselves killed, because both these people knew very well that the punishment for adultery was death, it was going to death. So here it shows that the high level of taqwa they had, the sincere repentance, that they are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah forgives them.
Some beautiful examples and stories from wonderful companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thank you very much for that, Dr. Zakir. Dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, we will meet soon after this short break.
It is Ramadan.
Dear viewers, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum. May peace be on you. It's my profound pleasure to welcome all of you to watch Peace TV.
Rejoice Ramadan with Peace TV. Now also being telecast in USA and Canada. You, your friends, relatives and others can tune into Peace TV in USA and Canada on Galaxy 25K3, 97 degrees west, 2x3, vertical, symbol rate 28125, frequency 11789, and on World TV 65. Now, Peace TV being telecast worldwide. Watch it. For more information, log on to www.peacetv.org and www.peacetv.tv. Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
If any Muslim makes the statue of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and he worships it, and if you being a non-Muslim, knowing knowledge of Islam, if you go and destroy the statue, even if the full Muslim world is against you, I, Dr. Zakir Naik, will support you. Because making a statue of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is prohibited.
This book, people, they should know about it. Our strength inside. This is the proof, the irrefutable evidence. This Quran changed the Arabs, O Ummah of the Quran. It's very powerful because it's the word of Allah. If all Muslims hold to this robe of Allah, no power, no force on earth can do anything to us.
It is Ramadan.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back to the show, Ramadhaan, a date with Dr. Zakir. I'm your host, Yusuf Chambers, and today we are discussing the topic, Ramadhaan, the month of repentance, part two. Dr. Zakir, if we could just now clarify, what is the best time in one's life to seek repentance? Is there a best time indeed?
Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 17, that Allah accepts the repentance of the person who has done sin in ignorance, and he asks for forgiveness quickly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most merciful and is the most knowledgeable and wise. Now here, based on the commentary of this verse of the Quran, according to Mujahid, Allah have mercy on him, he said that the sin in ignorance means that any sin done knowingly or unknowingly, unless the person does not come away from the sin, it is done ignorantly. That means all the sins Allah forgive, as long as a person repents quickly. As far as quickly is concerned, according to Hassan Basri, may Allah have mercy on him, he said quickly here means before death. And Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said quickly here means that before a person has a sickness, which is mentioned in the hadith of a beloved Prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hadith Medi, book of applications, hadith number 3537, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept the repentance of his servant till his death rattle begins. That means till the time he goes on his deathbed, unless he is in the last stage of life when he is on deathbed, that is the only time Allah will not accept the repentance. Anytime before that, he will accept. So that means all the scholars unanimously agree that quickly here in this Quranic verse, Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 17, means that we should ask forgiveness before death. Allah says in Surah Az-Zumur, chapter 39, verse 54 to 58, it says that turn to your Lord in repentance before the penalty comes, before it's too late. Unless your soul says that I have done a wrong deed and I mocked, or the soul may say that please give me one more chance, but it will be too late. Allah says in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 1900, that when the time is over, when the time on the deathbed has come, and then you say that Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me one more chance. And Allah said that it's too late. There cannot be another chance given. So the time for repentance should be that if any sin is done in ignorance, you should repent as soon as possible, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His mercy, from His bounty, He will forgive you.
Jazakallah khair, Dr. Zakir, for answering the question. Dr. Zakir, another question which is of equal importance, if not more. A lot of people are concerned about this. I know I am myself. How do we know? What are indications? And how do we know whether repentance is accepted? What are the indications?
The indication as far as for repentance to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one, is that you do not commit the same sin again. And your good deeds keep on increasing, and your bad deeds keep on decreasing. This is number one sign that Allah has accepted your repentance. Number two, that you have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three is that you regret to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you keep on asking His forgiveness. Number four is that you are humble, and you always address Him in humility. So these are the four signs which show that your repentance has been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The signs of non-acceptance of the tawbah repentance is deficiency in the person's repentance, and he remembers the pleasures of the sins, and he gets preoccupied in continuing the sin. That's number one. Number two, he is so sure that his repentance will be accepted as though he has got immunity, and he's immune to it, and surely he'll be forgiven. That's number two. Number three is that his eyes don't cry, and his heart is hardened. Number four, there's no increase in the good activities that he's doing. No increase in the good deeds. And Abdullah bin Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 4, in the Book of Repentance, Hadith number 6621, that if the people do not commit any sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will wipe them out and replace with the people who commit sin and who ask for forgiveness so that Allah can forgive them. Now here, if you understand this hadith, it will look very odd that does Allah want us to do sin? That if you don't do sin, Allah will remove you. What it means that there are some people who may do sin and who may ask for forgiveness and repent and may come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the good deed will increase. And these people will go to Jannah. On the other hand, some people do good deed and they have a conceit. They are so proud of themselves, and that will take them to the hellfire. So Allah says that if there is a group of people who don't do sin, Allah will replace them with the people who do sin so that they will ask for forgiveness and Allah will forgive them. That means you should have humility. So these are the signs for not acceptance of your tawbah.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to accept repentance and our tawbah, Dr. Zakir. Dr. Zakir, there is another question which I have, which is just to end this particular session, this particular show, and that is there any limitation to the sins that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can accept our tawbah for?
As far as Allah's forgiveness is concerned and His mercy is concerned, every surah, every chapter of the glorious Quran, it begins with the beautiful formula, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Every surah except for chapter number 9, Surah Tawbah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, chapter number 39, verse number 53, that, O my servants who have transgressed against their souls, despair not the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Allah can forgive all sins. Allah is of forgiving and most merciful. Here Allah says that whatever your sin may be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can forgive any of your sins as long as you repent. If you repent the right way and if you ask forgiveness, Allah will inshallah forgive you. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Hadith of Ibn Majah, Hadith number 4251, the beloved Prophet said that every son of Adam, he commits sin. And the best is the person who repents. If you commit sin, no problem, but if you repent, then you're the best person. Repentance is very important. It's mentioned Hadith of Tirmidhi, Hadith number 3540, where the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah says, O son of Adam, you may do any sin, and I will forgive all your sins. Even if your sins reach to the clouds in the sky, I will forgive them. You ask me for mercy, and I will forgive you. It's further mentioned Hadith of Sahih Muslim, Hadith number 6246, that the beloved Prophet ﷺ said, that Allah says, even if you do sin day and night and ask for forgiveness, I will forgive you. You ask me for pardon and I will forgive you. It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 8, hadith number 5999. There were some prisoners of war who were released, mainly children and women. And one lady, she searches for a son and she cannot find a son. The moment she sees any child, she breastfeeds that child. Then another child she sees, she breastfeeds the child. Finally, she finds her own child. So the Prophet asked the Sahabas that when this woman finds her son, even if he has done a sin, then will she throw the son in the fire? They said no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves his servants, even if they commit sin, more than the lady loves the child. So based on this, we realize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is willing to forgive any of your sin as long as you repent. And just a last quotation, Allah says in the Quran, and in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 48, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleases, He can forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk, He'll never forgive. For that, a person has strayed far away. Here it means that if a person does shirk and repents before he dies, before the death rattle, inshallah Allah will forgive even the sin of shirk. If he repents and comes to the straight path and believes in one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believes in Tawheed, Allah will even forgive him his sin of shirk, which is the biggest sin. But if he dies as a mushrik, after he dies, Allah says here that he will not forgive the sin of shirk. Any other sin if he wishes, he may forgive, but the sin of shirk, he'll never forgive. Shirk is the biggest sin. So from here we come to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful and is willing to forgive the sins of his servants.
Subhanallah. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. Dr. Zakir, thank you very much for answering all the questions on the topic today. It's such an important topic it was. Myself, I feel sure that now I will know exactly how to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during this wonderful month of Ramadan and use every breath of the 30 days, inshallah, for the benefit.
Allah accept all our repentance in this glorious month.
Ameen, ameen. All of the Muslims, inshallah. And let's hope that some of the non-Muslims will take the benefit of this wonderful month, and they also will ask with sincerity and the correct methodology for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's guidance, and Allah will accept their repentance as well.
Inshallah.
Dear brothers and sisters, we come to the end of the show. We weren't able to answer all of your questions regarding the topic, but inshallah, tomorrow we will endeavor to answer all of those questions. So, join us tomorrow when we will be discussing the topic, Ramadan, the month of supplications. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi وبركاته.
حافظين ذاكرين قانتين خاشعين مسلمين مؤمنين للإله عابدين شهرنا صوم وعتق وقنوت فيه صدق يومنا صبر ورق بدموع البائسين رمضان قد أهل بالصيام وأطل مصعدا أهلا وخلا
A friendly message by Dr. Zakir, the touchstone of theology.
Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. Theology means the study of God. Surah Ikhlas is the litmus test for the study of God. It is the 112th chapter of the glorious Quran, verses 1 to 4. Kul huwallahu ahad. Say, He is Allah who is one. Allah hus samad. Allah, the eternal absolute, the eternal refuge. Lam yalid walam yulad. He begets not, nor is he born. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Nor is there to him any equivalent. It is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 6, Kitab al-Fazail al-Quran, chapter number 13, Hadith number 533. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, Surah Ikhlas is equal to the one-third of the Quran. There are four criteria for the verification of the true God. The first is Ahad. He is one. The second is As-Samad, the eternal absolute, the eternal refuge. The third is Lam Yalid Walam Yulad. He begets not, nor is he born. The fourth is Walam Yakun Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. Nor is there to him any equivalent. Verify today whether the God you worship is true or not, with the help of Surah Ikhlas, the touchstone of theology.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.